Thank you so much. 10 minutes is quite daunting. I will talk rapidly until I am thrown off the stage. As a psychiatrist, my major interest has been why do people want to hasten their death? But in order to get you there, let me talk a little bit about Oregon's Death with Dignity Act. It was passed by a citizens initiative in 1994. Many legal challenges. First deaths did not occur until 1998. It allows a physician to prescribe a lethal dose of medication to a requesting patient for the purposes of self-administration, and there's a series of safeguards. You have to be an adult, you have to be a resident of the state, you have to make two oral and a written request over 15 days to prevent impulsive requests. An attending and a second physician must confirm that you have a terminal illness, that you're capable of making decisions, that it's voluntary. You have to be told the feasible alternatives, such as hospice and comfort care, though, as I'll explain to you, actually most patients are enrolled in hospice when they die by physician aid in dying. You have to, they have to ask you to notify your family, though you don't have to comply. And if there's concern about depression or another mental illness impacting your decision, you need to be evaluated by a psychiatrist or a psychologist. As part of the law, there's a requirement that the physicians report information about the patients who receive these lethal prescriptions, and a requirement that the Oregon Health Division publish statistics yearly. If legal requirements are not met, there's a possibility that the state licensing board could talk to you about that. There have been some minor issues around that. It's not considered suicide under the law. The death certificate says that you die of your underlying disease. And between 1998 and the last time that there was statistics reported in 2013, there have been about 700 over 750 deaths, increase from 1 in 1,000 deaths to about 2 in 1,000 deaths currently. Oregon stood alone for many years in this practice until a few years ago when neighboring state Washington also through a citizens initiative legalized assisted dying, and Their law is almost identical to Oregon, and we're just beginning to get data from them. And then the state of Vermont through a legislative process. And then two other states, New Mexico and Montana, in which a judge has made it legal. However, there's no reporting requirements, so we would know almost nothing about the practices in those states. We've done a series of studies over the year that have looked at healthcare providers' views on physician aid in dying, and then their practices around it. So we have done studies of psychiatrists, psychologists, eligible physicians, hospice nurses, hospice social workers. I went to presented at a hospice conference, and the chaplains were incensed that I had not studied them, so we included hospice chaplains. And all of these surveys have very high response rates. And most of them have been followed by qualitative interviews of the healthcare providers. I don't know why it doesn't like me. Then more recently, we have done studies of patients who've actually requested lethal prescriptions, and then family members. A little bit about healthcare providers' views on aid in dying. About half of physicians and hospice nurses support the law. About 70% of hospice social workers support the law. Probably higher because they have such a strong ethos of client empowerment. even though half of physicians support the law, only a third of are willing to prescribe under the law. So one of the criticisms of the law has been that sometimes the physicians don't know the patients very well, but that's because the patient has had to change physicians late in the course of their illness in order to find a willing physicians. Even though a third of hospice nurses oppose the law, in fact, only a very small number would be unwilling to care for a patient who'd made a request for assisted suicide. And no hospice chaplain would refuse to care for one of these patients. And I think that reflects that in the moral hierarchy, it is worse to abandon a patient than to make your worries about assisted suicide known. A little bit about the information from the Oregon Health Division. One of the worries about the act was that it would be socioeconomically vulnerable people who would make these requests. In fact, 97% of deaths have been in people who are white. The rest are Asian. There have been no African American deaths to date. 53% are men. About 80% have cancer, and another 7% have amyotrophic lateral sclerosis or motor neuron disease. 90% are enrolled in hospice. So in the United States, a hospice enrollment is almost always something that occurs in patients' homes. And 95% of people who die by aid in dying do die in their home. This is a very strong ethos, particularly in Oregon, which has the lowest rates of in-hospital deaths in the United States, in part because people do not want to die in hospital. The biggest risk factor for dying is being educated. So people who die by assisted suicide are 8 times more likely to have a bachelor's degree, and being educated is one of the biggest predictors of socioeconomic status in the United States. So this is not an issue of people who cannot access other kinds of care. I keep hoping it'll just magically happen. When you look at other characteristics of people who die, one of them in our studies has been the low degree of religious affiliation. So we, in all of our studies, we, you know, have a 1 to 10 scale where 1 is religion's not important to me, 10 is religion's very important to me. Patients usually come in with a mean about 6 or 7, hospice nurses the same. People who die by, who want lethal prescriptions have a mean score of 2. They are the singular most unreligious group of people that I have ever worked with. We have been looked at the reasons why people want aid in dying in terms of symptoms. Most people at the time they're making their request have almost no physical symptoms as part of their terminal illness, for example, cancer. That is not the motivation. But when you ask them, what are your worries about the future? Worries about pain and other physical symptoms are very prominent as a reason for these requests. Other concerns have been about patient depression. We found that, for example, social workers rated depression as among the least important reasons why people request aid in dying. But in a study of patients in the process of making this request, about a quarter of them did have significant depressive symptoms. Depression was not an important reason, and some of them actually were able to get lethal prescriptions. So this is one of the areas in the law that for which there's a potential vulnerability of patients. What are the major reasons people make these requests? Well, when we interview them, what they really talk about is the importance of staying in control, not being dependent on other people, not losing independence, not wanting to be cared for by other people, and wanting to die at home. Those are the major motivators. As I mentioned, in addition to studies in which we're having people mark, you know, quantitative ratings of these, we also do qualitative interviews. And I think that's where I think you get an idea about what the motivations are. So in all of these studies, when we interview physicians and hospice nurses, they describe patients. With regard to control, each of these is a quote from a healthcare provider about a patient who had made a request. Different provider in every case. One of them said, "But these were individuals who wanted to control their lives, and it was mostly a control issue. And they sort of stated that right up front. It had nothing to do with the care that they were getting, and they would return to it and return to it. And you could say, you know, we are doing all we can. We're trying to make this commitment to you, and we're trying to take care of you. But you know, they fixated on ending their lives from the get-go." Another physician on another patient. "I think her big fear was loss of control. She wanted to control things right up to the end. She wanted to plan it. She wanted it to go the way she wanted it to. And she didn't want to wait. She did not want to take the chance that she wouldn't be under control anymore. She was very in charge. And you know, some people like that can be a little difficult." But she was not like that. So in summary, the reasons we found in Oregon why people make requests for physician aid in dying is low measures of religiousness, strong need for control, prizing self-sufficiency, wanting to avoid dependence on others, struggle to find meaning in the dying process, fear of worsening symptoms, and lack of denial about their terminal illness. Thank you.
This is modern technology. So I send it this morning to my email address, and I have it on my iPad now. So otherwise, I didn't have any handout for reading my presentation. Anyway, thank you for the invitations to the organizers, especially to Ben and Lindy. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm very honored to be invited to this conference. Most of the invited speakers say quite some cliche things, like it's a wonderful city. It is a wonderful city. It's a wonderful conference. It is a wonderful conference. But I also will say, okay, fantastic. I also will tell you why it's such a wonderful conference and why it's such a pleasure to be here. I'm doing in between 15 and 20 years research, not only on palliative care, but also on end-of-life decisions, and specifically on euthanasia for 20 years. For 20 years, we have been trying to present our research in Europe, and it was always a struggle within the palliative care community to present these results in a very relaxed way. And I found this conference gives me the opportunity to present in a relaxed way, because there was lots of debates and there was not. But first, what we get is a lot of emotions in Europe when you present these results. Sometimes we get aggression in the room, sometimes people are leaving the room, and we are only researchers, so we are not the doctors in Belgium who are committed to euthanasia. So that's the atmosphere that we have been struggling with, also Agnes from the Netherlands, over the last 20 years, so it's a completely relief to be in such a relaxed environment. So coming to the situation in Belgium on euthanasia, first of all, I think it's interesting to reflect about the definition and about what is allowed and what's not allowed. So definition of euthanasia according to the Belgian law on euthanasia is the administration of drugs with the explicit intention to end the life of a person at his or her explicit request. And it's very clear by law in other articles of the law that the person who can do that is only a physician. So you have to be qualified physicians to do that. But there's a number of due care criteria which are very explicit in the law. And the most important are the ones on this slide. The physician knows the patients well enough. He knows whether the request for euthanasia is both voluntary and well considered by the patient. In order to know that, you have to know your patients very well. So it's not a one consultation that you can know this request from. The physician knows whether his or her medical situation is without prospect of any improvement, and whether his or her suffering is unbearable. So the unbearably suffering is one of the crucial criteria and safeguards of the law. And the patient has to be, of course, fully informed for this about his or her situation, namely about the diagnosis and the prognosis. And that's something which the second physician will also check. The different safeguards will be checked by a second physician. And the patient is also well informed about all possible therapeutic or treatment options at the end of life which may be considered. There's also a number of procedural due care criteria mentioned in the law on euthanasia in Belgium. The request for euthanasia by the patient must be repeated, consistent, and also written. So you, at the end, you need to have a written request, which is different from the Netherlands, where you don't need a written request. And the attending physician needs to consult another, what is called in the law, an independent physician. That means that you can't take your neighboring physician, which is on the same ward. You really and you can't have a hierarchical relationship with the second physician. So it needs to be an independent physician. And the physician has to report the case to the Federal Control and Evaluation Committee in Belgium, and we only have one compared to the Netherlands, where there are several people. And it's composed by 60 members, a physician or physicians, lawyers, and end-of-life specialists. So coming to the research, of course, we are doing about 15 to 20 years of research on euthanasia. I can only give you a flavor, but I think I've drafted it in a way, in a very simple way. I'm not going to give you very complicated statistics. And the first question is, what is the incidence of euthanasia in Belgium? And I'm focusing on two studies that we have done, a study in 1998, and the most recent study, and we're working on the last study, which hopefully will get published by the end of the year. But the previous study was done in 2007. And interestingly, the law was voted in 2001 and implemented in 2002. So we have a clear situation before the law, and we have a very clear, reliable measurement about 6 years after the law, but we have a kind of time window of 10 years of developments in Belgium. And what you see is, very importantly, is this is a very important figure, which because that shows the number of medicalized deaths in our society, and they are rapidly growing. So these are all the deaths that have been preceded by at least one medical end-of-life decision. And within a 10-year time frame, it has increased substantially from 40% to 50% almost. So that really implies that the medical professionals have a huge responsibility at the end of life of the patients who are dying. And it will increase that responsibility over the next years. And that's all caused by the epidemiological developments in our society and the medical developments. But what you see is that the physician-assisted dying didn't increase in 10 years' time. It was 4.4% of all deaths in 1998, and it was 3.8% in 2007. And euthanasia increased from 1.1% to 1.8%. So another question is, which physicians receive a request for euthanasia? And so we did also some surveys, representative surveys among the physicians in Belgium, more than 900 physicians who replied to the questionnaire. And 48%, and it was a representative sample of physicians, 48% received a request for euthanasia ever. 39% received a request since the law was implemented in 2002, and there was no differences between the religious backgrounds of the physicians. So Catholic physicians won't get less requests for euthanasia than an atheist physician, to make it or to state it simply. And what about the clinical specialties? Radiotherapists all get at least one request for euthanasia. Neurologist, among the neurologists, 73% of neurologists ever received a request. And as you can see, it's too far. This is the one. So most of the specialties have between 25 and 60% that have ever received a request. So when you look at the experiences of the end-of-life experiences of the physicians, medical doctors with training in palliative care or who are member of a palliative care team more often receive the request, which is quite the opposite what is mostly expected across the world, that palliative care will reduce the number of requests. So 49% of people in palliative care received a request versus only 30% of physicians who worked outside of palliative care. Medical doctors who cared for more than 10 terminal ill patients also received more requests, which is less of a surprise. In another study, we also found that within the settings of palliative care, the incidence outside the settings of palliative care, the incidence was 0.9%, and within the settings of palliative care, the incidence of euthanasia was 2%. So which patients received euthanasia? From the patients that we could study in this survey, 48% received euthanasia, 5% their request was rejected, 10% of patients withdrew their request, and 23% of patients died prior to the euthanasia, and 13% of patients still lived, meaning that euthanasia at least was delayed or never performed at all. So for the reasons, actually they are pretty much similar to the reasons that were mentioned by Linda previously in her presentation. So the number one reason for mentioned by 72% is the suffering without prospect of any improvement. So another question is, how did the incidence of euthanasia develop over the year? And these are figures based on the reported cases of euthanasia. And you see that there is a substantial and linear increase year after year after year from the beginning of the implementation of the law, where we had 235 cases of euthanasia reported, until last year in 2013 we had 1800 cases of euthanasia reported. So what are the characteristics of these practices of the euthanasia cases in Belgium? There's no differences between male and female. You see over the years there's almost 50-50% of male and female within euthanasia cases. If you look at the diagnosis, you see a disproportional representation of cancer patients. So the upper bar are the ones who receive euthanasia, and you see that's 83% of cancer patients and 70% of non-cancer. And cancer patients represent only 24% of all deaths in our society. You see that there's a huge, huge difference. When it comes also to the age distribution, you see that it far more often happens among the younger age groups, as only 18% of the older age groups, and there's 50% in the overall population. So coming to my conclusions, legal changes concerning euthanasia in Belgium since 2002 had a considerable impact on the incidence of end-of-life decisions in general. The performance of euthanasia since the euthanasia law in Belgium is increased. However, developments over time do not show any indications to support the slippery slope hypothesis or the hypothesis that euthanasia is applied in vulnerable groups. And euthanasia most often is chosen by younger patients and by patients with cancer in order to remain societal control over these last resorts end-of-life options. I think monitoring of this practice is very much needed. And I think external review of euthanasia in Belgium helps also to improve the quality of this end-of-life practice. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this kind introduction. It's not easy to be to tell you something new at this stage after the first two presentations, both concerning the pleasure it is to be here at this conference as with regard to the content of my presentation and the practice of euthanasia and other end-of-life decisions in the Netherlands, because this practice much resembles practices both in Belgium and in Oregon, with concerning the characteristics of patients who ask for euthanasia, the reasons why they ask for it, their diseases they have, and especially with respect to Belgium, concerning the law and how things are regulated. Nevertheless, I will give my presentation as I prepared it, on the one hand to demonstrate that it really resembles each other, and secondly because there are perhaps some details that are differing and that are interesting to look at. I was planning to first explain to you what the Dutch euthanasia law is, then to show you some data about practices, and finally to give you an impression of how the review of euthanasia cases works and what current topics of debate are in our country. Definitions have already been presented by Luc, and in the Netherlands, euthanasia is defined similarly to the definition in Belgium. However, the Dutch euthanasia explicitly also includes physician-assisted suicide, which is not the case in Belgium. In the Netherlands, physicians are also allowed to prescribe lethal medication so that the patient can take these drugs him or herself. What euthanasia is not is ending of life without a patient request. That is not considered euthanasia in the Netherlands, for example, in neonates. It is not intensive alleviation of pain or symptoms by, for example, morphine, where hastening of death is a non-intended side effect. And it is also not withdrawing or withholding life-sustaining treatment. A very short overview of the history of the euthanasia law. During the 60s and 70s of the last century, there have been several court cases. And these resulted in the appointment of a state commission by the government, who had to give the government advice about whether or not it would be a good idea to legally regulate the practice of euthanasia. And that was in 1985. And this commission advised that it would be a good idea to allow euthanasia, provided that the conditions under which this practice could be allowed were specified. In 1993, there was a more or less official review procedure that included criteria for due care and criteria physicians had to adhere to when they engaged in the practice of euthanasia. And these criteria, they had to report their cases to the public prosecutor, and the public prosecutor reviewed the case and judged whether or not these criteria were adhered to. Physicians did not feel comfortable with this system because they said, now it's only a legal expert who looks at our practice, whereas we think it's better that also a medical expert looks at the practice, looks at our practices. And that is why in 1998, review committees, multidisciplinary review committees, were started. We have now five of these committees in the Netherlands. They include a legal expert, a medical doctor, and an ethicist, and the three of them together judge whether or not the case is okay. And in 2002, finally, the euthanasia law was officially accepted, but practice had already been developed and was already practiced, so the law was merely an official codification of practice and did not bring really new elements into this practice. The nice thing in the Netherlands is that in between these developments, we did studies. We studied the incidence and characteristics of end-of-life decision-making practices. We started to do that in 1990. I was not involved in that study at that time, but my involvement started in 1995. And in the meantime, we have done five subsequent studies, all using the same methodology and the same type of questions, so that developments can be carefully followed. And I will show you some data from these five follow-up studies. The central idea of the euthanasia law, as can be derived from what I told you, is that ending of life can be an acceptable practice in specified situations. It should be practiced within the medical domain. And societal control is essential to safeguard the practice. And that is why physicians have to report their cases to the review committees and why there are criteria for due care they have to adhere to. The procedure is that the physician has to notify a case to the coroner who presents the information to the multidisciplinary committee. The committee assesses whether or not the criteria for due care have been adhered to, and cases are then only forwarded to the public prosecutor when the committee thinks that the criteria are not adhered to. So the public prosecutor only sees exceptional cases. What are the criteria of due care? More or less the same as in Belgium. The patient has made a voluntary and well-considered request. The patient has to be suffering unbearably and without any hope of relief. The patient is well informed about his prospects and situation. There must be no alternatives, no acceptable alternatives to relieve suffering. And two procedural requirements are that an independent physician has to be consulted to judge the first four criteria, and that the physician performs the act with due care. Well then, practices. First of all, I think it is important to acknowledge that the euthanasia law and the euthanasia practice is really widely endorsed in the Netherlands. Both the general public and the medical professionals support the law. For the large majority, here you can see that even more than half of all physicians have ever engaged in a practice of euthanasia. They have performed euthanasia at least once in their career. Another about third has never done so but is willing to do so, and it's only 10 to 15% of physicians who say, I will never perform euthanasia, and the majority of them is willing to refer patients to other physicians who are willing to do so. So there is really wide support among the medical community for this system in the Netherlands. Then the incidence. I think it's important also to acknowledge that euthanasia is not a very common practice. It is, as you can see here, practiced in less than 5% of all deaths in the Netherlands, and other end-of-life decisions that also have an effect on the moment of dying are much more common, such as alleviation of symptoms where the physician acknowledges that that may hasten death, and non-treatment decisions, decisions to refrain from potentially life-prolonging treatment. I can't go into details here, but I have widened the data about euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide, and here you can see that, well, first of all, euthanasia is much more common than physician-assisted suicide. Physicians prefer to control the act of ending a patient's life by providing the medication themselves instead of letting the initiative with the patient. Well, you could say many things about that, but that's apparently how it works. You can also see that after the adoption of the law in 2002, the figures for euthanasia dropped, but that after apparently we got used to the law and we knew how it worked and what the risks for physicians were, whether or not they would be prosecuted, the figures rose again. And well, we hope to do the sixth round of our study in 2015, next year, and of course we are very curious what incidents we will find by that time. I think this is also a very important slide that shows the incidence of ending of life without a patient asking for it. In 1990, when the first study was done, this data attracted much attention, and it was then sometimes called the 1,000 cases of Remmelink. Remmelink was the person who initiated the study at that time. Cases where physicians ended the life of their patient without the patient having asked for it. And I think it's very reassuring to see that during the development of the criteria of due care and during the development of the euthanasia law, the number of these cases dropped, suggesting that once you have a euthanasia law, the result will not be that physicians more easily end the lives of their patients, but in contrast, that they are more aware that they should only do that when the patient asks for it. Whereas prior to the development of that criterion and the acknowledgement of the importance of that criterion, physicians apparently more easily ended their patients' lives without their explicit request. characteristics of cases, well known. The majority are patients with cancer. The majority are not among the oldest age groups, but in the age groups under 80 years of age. The life expectancy of the majority of patients is less than 1 month, so they are really in the very terminal stage of their disease. And 90% of all cases is practiced by family physicians, just like Linda told about the Oregon situation. This one I'll skip for the sake of time. Then one slide about reporting. In 1990, when the first study was done, we found that in total 18% of all cases that we found in research were reported. And along the development of the criteria and the reporting system, this percentage increased to about 80% of all cases that are reported. And we know now that the 20% that is not reported mainly concerns cases that are in the so-called gray area, in which are not so much explicit cases of euthanasia, but more cases in which morphine is used to either or not intendedly hasten death. Among the 35,000 reported cases in those somewhat over 10 years, approximately 14 cases were not approved, so that's a very small minority, and physicians adhere to the criteria in the very large majority of all cases. I will skip this one because my time is up. These are the current topics of debate in the Netherlands, and they must seem familiar to me because several of them were discussed during these 2 days too, which shows that once you have a euthanasia system, the debate doesn't end. In contrast, more and more topics are discussed, which is, I think, a good thing. Thank you very much for your attention.
And I have to start with an apology. Because of my flights to New Zealand, I will be leaving with an almost indecent haste at 4:45. But if people do have questions that they don't get a chance to ask, I'm perfectly happy for people to email me, and I'm easily found on the internet. You can't hide anywhere these days. I do hope people don't mind me using the term medical decisions at the end of life. I don't have a great commitment to this expression. It just happens to be the one that we were using in the days when we conducted the studies to which Constance just referred in terms of illegal euthanasia in New Zealand. I'm a bit of a sort of odd one out in this panel because everyone else is in the nice position of being able to talk about things that are perfectly legal, whereas, of course, in New Zealand, we are in quite a different position. Basically, we're interested in lots and lots of different kinds of decisions, not just those that are illegal, also ones that are legal and how people come to make these decisions, and in some cases, decisions which may be of somewhat dubious or uncertain legality. But I'm going to talk primarily about the ones which are clearly illegal, and here particularly voluntary euthanasia and assisted suicide. I first started to get involved in this when I arrived in New Zealand from the UK in 95. And we did a whole series of studies looking at issues relating to aspects of medical decisions at the end of life. These are not just the surveys of what was happening. We were interested in some of the parameters that might influence people's views, people's attitudes, people's perspectives, and also some of the predictors of what made people more likely or less likely to view some of these things sympathetically. It'll come as no surprise to many of the people here, I suspect, that, for example, when we compared medical practitioners, young adults and older people, what we found was that medical practitioners were very, very, very uncertain about this idea of voluntary euthanasia or assisted suicide. Young people were generally often reasonably okay, but the people who were most in favour were the people for whom it was the most pressing issue, which is the older people in society. In New Zealand, both assisted suicide and euthanasia are illegal. When I first arrived in New Zealand, it was illegal to commit suicide. You didn't actually have very clear penalties for what happened if you were successful. We published a large survey just over 10 years ago, which I have to say I was really quite pleased with at the time because it's a very difficult area to research, and we'd agonized over many, many of the issues that are involved. And I have to here give tremendous acknowledgement to my European colleagues, because much of what we did was basically plagiarized entirely from them. The format of the survey we did was hardly different, except for change of language, to those that had been done in Holland and so on. And I apologize also for the misplaced apostrophe there. I must have been typing in a hurry. Survey is certainly less than perfect. I don't think we have any absolutely perfect research in any of the countries where we are looking at things that are illegal. And I think there are good reasons for that. But we were very fortunate in getting the majority of GPs to sample and getting nearly half of those to take part in the study. I should emphasize that in New Zealand, end-of-life care is very much a matter for general practitioners. Others do get involved, but the vast majority of deaths would be in the hands of general practitioners. The bad news is the findings were in many ways quite boring. In fact, they're in many ways unbelievably boring, but I find the fact that they were boring really, really fascinating. Because what it did show was that we were actually very consistent with other countries where similar studies had been done. Around 5 to 6% of deaths seemed to involve the administration of a drug with the explicit intent of hastening life. So this is something which would be, by most authorities, regarded as clearly illegal in New Zealand and corresponding to what we generally think of as voluntary euthanasia. However, in about half of these, there is actually no discussion with the patient. And again, this is the kind of figure we see in a lot of countries. When you make things illegal, not surprisingly, people are sometimes a little wary of even raising the issue, because someone mentions, oh, the doctor was talking to me about possibly being helped to die. And the next thing you know, you're being investigated and prosecuted. The one thing that was interesting, I think, from our findings that hadn't been looked at in previous studies, and it corresponds entirely with what we see now from previous speakers, access to palliative care did not make any worthwhile difference. The people who had been doing this were just as likely to have access to palliative care as the people who didn't. And for me, as someone working clinically in palliative care, that wasn't entirely surprising, but it did actually reassure me a lot. Now, what's been happening since? Well, we definitely need an update of that. The most recent attempt to do so was by a colleague, Philippa Malpas, but she had trouble getting a suitable response rate, so this is still waiting to be done. We do have a lot of public opinion polls, generally finding majority support. I actually think that the commercial opinion poll people are probably, by and large, good people to do these kinds of studies, better than academics who tend to get terribly, terribly complicated. Opinion poll survey companies have very great deal of expertise. They tend to get very good sampling, and their figures tend generally to be quite good. I would, however, cast a little doubt on the New Zealand Herald one, which is the kind of digipoll in which you might get a certain degree of bias. I did want to talk a little bit about Australia, and it's a daunting prospect because I know there are people in the audience who know Australia better than I do, and much of my, if not most of my information is secondhand. But again, everything is illegal here, with the exception, as most of you will know, of the Northern Territory legislation, which was more short-lived than some of the people to whom the treatments were administered. Interestingly, we have, again, the same sort of thing. Illegal acts are taking place. This is not, although it might appear at first glance, a markedly different figure to what's being seen elsewhere, because this is a figure of the people who are involved, not of the deaths, and it's important to distinguish that. And certainly, if we look at UQ medical students, not far from here, around half of them feel that in some circumstances, medical professions should be involved in these areas. Public opinion, very much, if not better than New Zealand, real support. And this is one of my favorite ones. If you really want to get your politicians on board, point out that people are more likely to change their vote if you vote against voluntary euthanasia liberalization than if you vote for it, about four times as likely. Opposing euthanasia costs you votes. And also reassuring, it's not the case that if you are a Christian, you need oppose it. All the Christian groups had a majority of people in favour. But what about the professionals? Oh dear. New Zealand. New Zealand Medical Association regards this as unethical and will continue to do so even if the law changes. They are quite explicit. Australia is not much better. It's quite clear that they regard this as unethical, though they do at least reserve the option of changing their view subsequently. The law is sweet. Poor lawyers do have to prosecute, but my impression is that they often do seem to deal with cases sympathetically. In New Zealand, for example, a couple of cases I was very involved in, the Leslie Martin case. She was involved in, charged with the attempted murder of her mother, who was dying of cancer. Sean Davison, who was convicted on assisted suicide. In both cases, home detention was offered as an option. Leslie Martin actually declined this. She felt she had a point to make. And again, the sentences were fairly short, 15 months in Leslie's case, 5 months in Sean's case. And I have to express thanks to both Leslie and Sean for taking part in some of our more recent research where, like Cam Linder, we've been looking in depth qualitatively at some of the issues and doing detailed interviews with a number of people in this kind of situation. Sean was indeed still serving his sentence when he took part in our interviews. My impression is that the Australian courts also seem to be moderately sympathetic, at least in some cases. The two cases here, both assisted suicide cases, John Godfrey, which I think dates back probably to at the same time as Leslie Martin, the 2003-2004, and more recently the Shirley Justin's cases. Suspended sentence in one case, and as I understand it, weekend detention in the other. So, where does this leave us? Where it leaves us, I think, is exactly what this conference has been reinforcing over and over and over to me in almost every session I've been to. There are conflicts between the popular view and official positions. There are many cases where people are acting illegally. The law is not stopping this from happening. It is simply meaning that things are operating illegally. There is a risk that when people do act illegally, then they are going to do so without due process. And I'm also slightly concerned that while we have this kind of restrictive legislation, those who do feel in good faith that it is the right thing to do, nonetheless, don't do so because they are afraid of prosecution. So thank you.
So the first question, I feel a little bit like either a bingo caller or Santa Claus, I'm not sure which it is directed specifically to Linda. And the question reads, patients with motor neurone disease will have to take the prescribed drug while they physically can, but if euthanasia was legal, they may choose to die later. Is there any push to change the law?
Can you hear me?
Yes, so, you're mic'd.
About 7% of all deaths from Aiden dying in Oregon are people with ALS. They are 30 times more likely than all other Oregon deaths to choose this method. They probably do need to make the choice earlier than they might because of loss of motor function, but the law says that they need to self-administer. And self-administer has a variety of methods. So we actually use a fair number of gastrostomy tubes in people with ALS because I think it has palliative, people aren't fighting to eat as much, they have better energy. So somebody could self-administer through their gastrostomy tube, for example, if they had ALS. So the other part of the question is there a fight to extend the law? And I want to riff for a minute on this. Because in Oregon, really, since the law passed, what has happened is to understand the values and to try and look at all of the ways in which people don't die the way they want to die. And to remove barriers. And I've talked to a lot of people here, and I think Australia has a fair number of barriers. And there was a little swipe, I think, at American medicine. There's lots of problems with American medicine. But Oregon is kind of an area of rationality in this. And so I just want to take about 2 minutes to talk about my mother. Everybody talked about their mother in the conference. So my mother has dementia.
She lost the ability to live independently about 3 months ago. In Oregon, when you lose that ability, most people move into what's called adult foster care. Small homes with 3 to 5 people in them, they're regulated by the state, where they get care in a home environment. And so this is about 2 miles from where I live. In addition, she's not hospice eligible because she still has, you know, maybe a mini mental state of 15. But she has an organization that delivers all of her care in this foster care. They come, they're geriatricians. And even though she has dementia, about 3 months ago, she could have a goals of care discussion where she said, I never want to go to the hospital again. This is what everybody in Oregon says. So there's a plan for her that she will never go to the hospital again. Now, the exception to that, and she has, is that if she had, you know, broke a limb or something and needed pain control that they couldn't get. But she has a pulse, a physician's order for life-sustaining treatment. And this piece of paper goes with her. She goes into the ambulance. It clearly says that they are not to give her life-sustaining treatment on the way to the hospital, and they will not. And if that pulse gets lost, the ambulance drivers can access it on a state-wide monitoring system. So they can check her pulse. And the emergency room doctors will check her pulse. And in fact, most of her medical records are now on a statewide system, so that in case she gets diverted to the hospital that she, that a different hospital than the one that I'm heading to, because that happens, there's very little chance that she will get life-sustaining treatment and everything will be based on comfort care. So in Oregon, you hear about Aiden dying, but in fact, really what the focus has been on is about removing the barriers so that people get the kind of trajectory to death that is focused on comfort within the way. So that's just a little riff. But so it's not about expanding Aiden dying. It's working backwards to look at all of the barriers and trying to change those.
Okay. Thank you very much, Linda. The next question is directed specifically to Luke. And the question is, why is the incidence of terminal sedation so much higher than euthanasia? Is this a patient or a doctor preference?
Patient or doctor preference?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I think, as I've shown on the figures, palliative sedation is more or less being applied within palliative care pretty recently, over the last 10 years. And it has increased rapidly over the last 10 years. But we have seen in several countries in Europe, at least, I don't know how it is in Australia, that increase happens. So I think first issue is that palliative care has been developed over the years in many countries in Europe. And I think one of the issues is that one of the consequences of that are, first of all, the symptoms are much better controlled for the terminally ill patients, but also the last resort option in palliative care has more often been chosen. We know from research that not all of these cases have been cases that had full consent, so where there was consultation with the patients prior to the event. But in many cases, it was also not possible to have a consultation or a discussion with the patients. So I think in it's a very complex medical practice, terminal sedation, and it covers a wide range of different clinical practices. And if the patient is competent, then you can compare it with situations of euthanasia, and you can go either for euthanasia or you can go for palliative sedation, but that's only on the condition that the patient is fully competent and that you can plan the sedations. Very often, sedations at the end of life are not planned, and there's an emergency, and there is no possibility. So there is just a beneficial action by the doctor to help the patients not dying with great suffering. And so that's a completely different situation than a situation where the patient has a number of options and where you can discuss these options.
Thank you. There's a question here for Agnes. And Agnes, the question is, what are your views on euthanasia for advanced dementia when there is an advanced care directive?
Well, I'm not sure whether my views are specifically important, but it's indeed a topic of debate in the Netherlands, because in the Dutch law there is a statement that says that written advance directives can replace concurrent oral requests, provided that the rest of the criteria of due care are still valid. But no one in the Netherlands knows what that means, because, for example, you have to assess at the time of the decision making and at the time that you provide euthanasia whether or not the patient is suffering unbearably and without any prospect of relief. How can you do that if you can't talk to the patient and ask the patient how his situation is? You have to assess that the patient is fully informed of his situation and his prospect. How can you do that if you can't ask the patient about these issues? So most people in the Netherlands consider this statement in the law as a theoretical statement that has no clinical relevance. It is introduced in the law at the time when especially our previous health minister, Els Borst, who also introduced the euthanasia law, thought that dementia might be a very important reason for patients to want a euthanasia, and that is why this statement was included. But I don't think that it was very well considered how to implement this statement. And in clinical practice, if patients with dementia want euthanasia because they fear the development of dementia, they have to ask for euthanasia in time, namely at a moment at which they are still able to talk to the doctor and discuss the options and fulfill the requirements. And I think that element of the decision making is so important that in practice I don't see how you can regulate euthanasia based on a written advance directive for incompetent patients. It's a completely different situation that cannot be regulated based on the law as we have it now. So I don't think that will be clinical practice in the Netherlands.
So I have a question that several of you may be able to speak to, which is pretty straightforward. What's the general cost of the euthanasia procedure? Any ballpark?
Not so much, I think.
Not so much?
No. Okay. There is no, can you hear me? So in Belgium, there's no special financial arrangements for doctors for euthanasia. So they have maybe one consultation then or something. Like many of them don't charge this consultation when they practice euthanasia because they don't feel comfortable about it.
And just if people are wondering about the sheer physical cost of drugs and so on, a lot obviously depends on the method you use, but if you look, for example, at Derek Humphrey's guidelines for ending your own life, then the cost of drugs involved is pretty much trivial.
Okay, so here's a question which says it's directed to any of them, but I'm going to say it's any of them in states where these activities are lawful. The question is, each of these speakers mentions a review committee which oversees practice. Do these committees have religious representation?
Yeah. Yes. In our case, I don't know the religious denomination of the physician members of the legal members of the review committees, but among the ethicists, there are certainly several religiously members with a religious background.
The same for Belgium. It's Belgium is a very complicated country when it comes to politics, and so it's a very balanced committee, including also balances across religious, non-religious doctors and other lawyers.
And Oregon has no review committee. Data is reported to the Oregon Health Division. They publish statistics. if there's some aspect of the law the physician is not in compliance with, it is reported to the Oregon Licensing Board, the physician may get sanctioned, has the risk of being sanctioned if they don't follow the law.
Okay. So another question that's also been put to all of you, taking us in a slightly different direction. It reads, with the rapidly aging population, do you see a risk that individuals with severe disabilities requiring 24/7 care will request assistance as they lose their primary support network, such as their parents, and feel like a burden on society?
So similar to Belgium and probably the Netherlands, extreme old age is a protective factor for dying by assisted death. And it's because by the time somebody gets to the age of 85, about a third to half of people will have the beginnings of a dementing disorder. And that is ultimately the cause of death. And dementia is a relative exclusion for aid in dying, because at the time you are terminally ill, you're going to lack capacity to go through the process. So to the degree that really disability in extreme old age is strongly related to cognitive impairment, I don't see that that is the particular concern.
Well, I agree, but I think there are some societal changes will might influence that practice. And I think we see it a little bit already in the data in Belgium, so it might... euthanasia might be practiced in older age, and it has to do with the educational level of the generations that are going to die. Because euthanasia is an outcome of a very intense communication between the doctor and the patients. And we see also that it is more often practiced among the higher educated people. And because education is also higher in general, within the lower age groups. Now the baby boomers are getting over the age of 65, and they have a completely other attitude towards patients' autonomy, for example. And so the ones who are going to request for euthanasia are the ones who have valued very much their own autonomy. So they are getting old, and so in the next 20 years' time, there will be also, I think, more requests for euthanasia among the, of course, when they are still competent and not in the situation that was described by Linda.
Okay. Can we turn for one more question? Okay. So this is directed to the European panelists, and it's a bit longer. So legalization of euthanasia or physician-assisted death has spread from the Netherlands to other lowland countries, but not to neighboring Germany. A Dutch colleague tells me that German doctors struggle to even give high-dose morphine at end of life. Their medical training and community attitudes seem constrained by the Holocaust and its association with Nazi euthanasia. Do you agree? Is this an accurate assessment of the situation there? And what do you see as the probable future development of end of life there? That's a bit of a big question, but jump on in.
Well, in Germany, the word euthanasia is pretty much a taboo. So they use the word Sterbenshilfe, which is the aid in dying, literally. So they try not to use the word euthanasia when they mean euthanasia. Having said that, I think there was a large taboo within the palliative care community about talking, and it's still pretty much a taboo. But from a scientific point of view, I have the feeling that there's more and more debate within the scientific community about the issue. But on a societal and a political level, it's undebatable. That's my opinion. I don't know.
Yeah, I agree. I have been invited to several conferences in Germany to explain the Dutch situation. And I must say, and that's especially medical conferences, and doctors are open to listen to me and to hear how in the Netherlands we do it. But the support in Germany itself, among physicians and probably also among other groups, is very low. As in most other European countries, there is a debate and there are people in favor of legalizing euthanasia also in Germany, but I don't expect that that will happen at short notice. No.
Okay, so that brings our panel to a close. I'd like you to please join me in thanking.